Good morning, students. Today we will discuss with the same chapter, that is breathing and exchange of gases. So here yesterday we had solved about 33 questions. Today we will go for the 34th question. Here the question is bulk of oxygen diffuses from plasma into red blood cells, okay, where it joins loosely with ferrous ions of hemoglobin to form bright red oxyhemoglobin. In blood there will be presence of RBC and as well as the plasma, which is a fluid substance of blood, and RBC, which are the cells. So here in the plasma, what happens means from the whatever the oxygen will be present in the blood, it is going to diffuse from plasma into red blood cells. Much amount of what we call oxygen is going to diffuse into whom? Into the red blood cells, where these red blood cells, where in the red blood cells there is a presence of hemoglobin. So these, after coming into this hemoglobin, it will joins with what? With the ferrous ions. Okay, ferrous ions of hemoglobin to form, after which it will form a oxyhemoglobin. What it will form? It will form a oxyhemoglobin. This process is called as, we are asking, what is this process is known as? Here there is an addition of oxygen. Okay, so what is the process? Oxygenation. Option B is the correct option. The next 35th question, you see, 35th question, given below are four matching of an animal and its kind of respiratory system, a respiratory organ. See here, see, given below are the four matching of animal and its kind of respiratory organ. First, silver fish. Fishes belong to the Pisces. Okay, all the fishes will they will respire through the, what we call, that is with the silver fish will come under the Pisces, and this silver fish respire through the pharyngeal gills. Here it is. Scorpion, which belongs to the arthropoda, and here they will respire through the book lung. Scorpion respire through the book lung. The next, sea squirt. Here they had given the silverfish, scorpion, given below are four matching of an animal and its kind of respiratory system. So correct matching are, the question is that we have to see what are the correct matching are there. Okay, so let's see. First, silverfish, that is going to respire through the trachea. Scorpion, that is going to, how the question is, scorpion book lung, okay, scorpion, that is belong to the arthropoda, which will respire through the book lung. Sea squirt, that is going to respire through the pharyngeal gills. Sea squirt, it is also one of the aquatic animal. And dolphin is also one of the aquatic animal, but they had given it as the skin. So this is a wrong option. This is not a correct matching, but they have to mention here it as the dolphin, as the gills. Okay, so what is the correct option? First is the correct one, second is the correct one, and third is the correct one. First, second, and third. So this option is the correct option. The next, let's go for the 36th question. You see, 36th question, this is the question. The figure shows a diagrammatic view of human respiratory system. Here there is one picture, or one figure is there of what? Of human respiratory system here with the labels A, B, C and D. Okay, they had given labeling as A, B, C and D. First we will see about the labelings. A is the trachea and B is the pleural membrane. Pleural membrane. C is the alveoli and D is the lower end of the or diaphragm also we can see, or lower end of the lungs diaphragm. So here the labels A, B, C, D, select the option which gives correct identification. Okay, which gives a correct identification. First we have to select it. In the options they had given some names or the labelings. Correctly I had mentioned here, but also we will see in the options. And their main function and our characteristic. Either we have to see the correct identification, then their main function or the characterism. Okay, so first we will see here. C is the alveoli. Okay, this is correct one. C is the alveoli. The next here they had given a alveoli, which is thin walled vascular bag like structure for exchange of gases. Yes, how is the alveoli? Here I will show you. This is thin walled. Okay, alveoli are the thin walled. This wall is very thin and you can see a somewhat a bag like structure. Okay, bag like structure, which is mainly meant for, or it is a site for exchange of gases. What it is? It is a site for exchange of gases. Then next, this is correct. Second one, lower end of lungs, diaphragm pulls it down during inspiration. During inspiration, it will not pull down, but it is going to contract. This is a wrong option. Trachea, long tube supported by complete cartilaginous rings for conducting inspired air. The thing is that trachea is supported. See here, trachea, you can see here, this option A1, trachea is supported by C-shaped incomplete rings of cartilage. C-shaped incomplete rings of cartilage. This is the correct characteristic of what? Trachea. But they had given long tube supported by complete cartilaginous. Okay. This is wrong one. Incomplete cartilaginous. You can write. Then this is also wrong. And the D option, you see B. Labeling is the pleural membrane. Okay, labeling is correct, but surrounds ribs on both sides to provide cushion. The first thing, they are not going to surround the ribs, they are going to surround the lungs. To whom they are going to surround? That is to the lungs. So this is also wrong option. So which is the correct one? A is the correct option, that is alveoli, which is thin walled vascular bag like structure for exchange of gases. The next 37th question, you see, which of the following factor will increase the Bohr's effect? Here I will explain you what do you mean by Bohr's effect. Here yesterday we had studied about the oxygen, what we call oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. It is somewhat associated with that only. Here in the Bohr's effect, whatever the dissociation curve you had seen, yesterday we had studied that this is the dissociation curve. In this way it is. This is a curve. This is a curve. Here it is. The graph is plotted against the partial pressure of oxygen, that is measured in mmHg. This is the axis and the x-axis, and this is the percentage saturation of hemoglobin. This is the y-axis. Okay, y and x-axis. So here, this is the normal shift or normal curve to show the dissociation curve. As the partial pressure of oxygen, it is going to increase. There is an increase in saturation of oxygen of hemoglobin. So here they are going to shift to the left side. This is shifted. This curve is shifted to left side. And one more thing, this curve can also be shifted to right side. Shifted to right side. Okay, this is about the dissociation curve. So here, what do you mean by shift to right? What is the factors or what are the things are going to take place here? Means, so here when it is shifted to right, first of all, here I will explain you. First of all, when it is shifted to right side, means the oxyglobin, it shows the following conditions. What is that means? There is a decrease in partial pressure of oxygen. This is the first condition. If there is a decrease in partial pressure of what? Oxygen. If this is going to decrease, then this curve is going to shift it to the right side. The next term, increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide. If there is a decrease in partial pressure of oxygen, then there will be decrease in partial pressure of carbon dioxide. Then what happens means, what about the hydrogen ion concentration and pH means, here there is an increase in hydrogen ion concentration. Hydrogen ion concentration, and one more thing, there is decrease in pH level. Okay, so this is about when shifted to right side. When shifted to left side, what are the conditions you can see means, when it is shifted to left side means, see here, the first thing, especially when it is going to shifted to the left side means, that is in the fetal blood. It takes place in the fetal blood. Okay, here in the fetal blood, what is going to happen means, first of all, in the fetal blood, the hemoglobin has more affinity for oxygen. So the hemoglobin can bind with more oxygen in fetal as compared to the to the adult. So that's why there is a decrease in hydrogen ion concentration. The next thing, there is an increase in pH. Okay, here there is a decrease in pH means, it will become acidity or acidic condition. Here the increase in pH means it will become alkalinity. Okay, and what about the partial pressure of partial pressure of oxygen is more, PO2 will be increased. What about the PCO2, that is partial pressure of carbon dioxide, it will be in decreased form. So this is about the when it is shifted to right and when it is shifted to left. Okay, so what is the question is asking here means, which all are the factors will increase the Bohr's effect. Next comes the term, that is Bohr's effect. One of the effect is there. Here, that effect is known as the Bohr's effect. Here, I explain you about the Bohr's effect. Okay. See, when shifting of oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve to right, when that curve, whatever the oxygen dissociation curve is there, when it is shifted to right side, okay, when it is shifted to right side, there is an increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide. Okay, and this effect is known as the Bohr's effect. Okay, when oxygen dissociation curve shifted to right side, at that time there is an increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide, and this is known as the Bohr's effect. Where you will found this Bohr's effect means, you can see this Bohr's effect in the tissue capillaries. Okay, where you will found this Bohr's effect means, that is in the tissue capillaries. The next thing, the presence of carbon dioxide decreases the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen and the increases the release of oxygen to the tissues. This is the thing which is going to happen in the Bohr's effect. Now the next thing, the pH of blood falls as its carbon dioxide content increases, so that when the partial pressure of carbon dioxide rises, the curve shifts to the right, and the whatever the how much it is going to rise means, in the graph you can see, that is, it will go up to the this till here when it is shifted to the right. That means P50. Okay, the next here, what are the factors they are telling, factors which are affecting to the Bohr's effect. Here you see factors affecting to Bohr's effect means, what you can write means, that is a whatever the factors you had studied that shifted to right side. What are that factors means, here you had already, I had told you, when it is shifted to right side, at that time there is an increase in oxygen, partial pressure of oxygen, there is a decrease in partial pressure of oxygen, increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide, there is an increase in hydrogen ion concentration, and decrease in pH. So all these are the factors which are affecting to the Bohr's effect. So let's see here in the what we call, that is in the 37th question, which of the following factors will increase the Bohr's effect. So here Bohr's effect is increased by increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide. The first thing, there is an increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide, then increase in hydrogen ion concentration. You can see here increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide and increase in hydrogen ion concentration. Then accept this decrease in pH and decrease in partial pressure of oxygen. Here in the first option they had given increase in partial pressure of oxygen. No, there is an decrease in partial pressure of oxygen when it is shifted to the right side. So this option is the wrong option. Then what is the next one means, that is a decrease in partial pressure of carbon dioxide. No, there is an increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide. This option is also wrong option. Increase in hydrogen ion concentration. You can see here there is an increase in hydrogen ion concentration. So this option is a correct option. Increase in body temperature. I forgot to tell you, there is an increase in body temperature. Okay, this is also one factor which will affect to the when the curve is shifted to the right side. So there is an increase in body temperature. This is also one thing. So here what is the answer? Here option third and fourth is correct, and fifth option is also there. High pH they had given, but here there is a low pH, that is the acidity. Okay, so this is also wrong. So third and fourth option are correct. You can see 1 2 3 4 1 2 4 5 3 4 5 and 3 4, only 3 and 4 option is correct. Third and fourth is correct. So D option is the correct option. Okay, then next we will go for the 38th question. You see, body tissues obtain oxygen from hemoglobin because of its dissociation in tissues is caused by, here this is going to cause one, wait a minute. See, 38th question you see, body tissues. Okay, body tissues obtain the oxygen from where? From the, this is the hemoglobin. They are going to get the oxygen from their hemoglobin, because when the blood reaches to the body tissues, there is a disassociation of what? Of oxygen in the tissues is going to cause. Why it is going to cause means, there is an increase in carbon dioxide. Okay, in what? In a blood. In blood itself, this is a blood or blood vessel, whatever the capillaries will be there. So here there is an increase in what? Carbon dioxide in blood causes the, these increment of carbon dioxide causes what? Causes the oxygen to be displaced from hemoglobin. Okay, increase in the concentration of carbon dioxide making the oxygen to be broken down from the hemoglobin. So what is going to happen? The presence of carbon dioxide decreases the affinity. Due to the presence of this carbon dioxide, this presence of carbon dioxide, what it is going to do means, it is going to decreases the affinity of hemoglobin from oxygen. Affinity of hemoglobin from oxygen, and increases the release of oxygen to the, due to this factor, when there is a decrease in the affinity of oxygen, due to this factor, there is an increase release of oxygen to the tissues. This is the thing which is going to take place when the blood cells the blood is going to transported, or it is going to carried to the tissues. At that time, there is more in the blood, there is a more concentration of carbon dioxide, due to which the oxygen is going to displaced from the what? From the hemoglobin, and after which there is a decrease in the affinity of what? Oxygen from where? From the hemoglobin. So it will increases the release of oxygen to the tissues. So here, body tissues obtain oxygen from hemoglobin. Okay, because of its disassociation in the tissues is caused by, here they had given low oxygen, okay, and carbon dioxide concentration. We cannot say low oxygen, there will be more oxygen and as well as the more carbon dioxide. So this is the wrong option. High oxygen concentration, no, there is an high carbon dioxide concentration, this is also wrong. Low carbon dioxide concentration, no, there is an high carbon dioxide concentration. And last one, high carbon dioxide concentration. So B is the correct option. The next, we will go for the next question. That is the 39th question. In the 39th question, you see, in the 39th question, you see, match the column 1 with column 2 and choose the correct combination from the option given below. Okay, so here the 39th question is that raises the ribs, intrapulmonary pressure is greater than atmospheric pressure. Okay, see, first I will tell you, when there is raises the rib, when it is going to raise ribs, okay, when whether the intrapulmonary pressure is more or intrapulmonary pressure is less, that we will see here. First thing, when the inspiration occurs, the pressure within the lungs, that is the intrapulmonary pressure, is lesser, okay, than the atmospheric pressure. See here, during inspiration, when See, first I will explain about the inspiration. Okay, during inspiration, intrapulmonary pressure, it will be more. Sorry, it will be whatever the pressure within the lungs will be there, it will be less than what? Less than atmospheric pressure. When? During the inspiration. During expiration, when gases are going to exhale, so at that time, the pressure inside the lungs, that is known as the intrapulmonary pressure, it will be more or higher than what? Than the atmospheric pressure. It will be higher than the atmospheric pressure. These are the two things. And when the ribs are going to raise here, means here, see, during inspiration, what are the things are going to happen? Means the ribs are going to, ribs and sternum, whatever the flat bone which is located at the ventral side of the thoracic cavity, that is known as the sternum. These ribs and sternum are going to raised when? During the inspiration. Okay, then what is going to happen means, see, during inspiration, one more thing I want to tell you, that here contraction of diaphragm is going to take place. Contraction of diaphragm when? During inspiration. These all conditions, first of all, the intrapulmonary pressure will be lesser than the atmospheric pressure. The second thing, there is a contraction of diaphragm during inspiration. Ribs and sternum are going to raise. This is a third thing. So here, what they are telling, volume of, what about the volume of thoracic chamber? Means here I will write the volume of thoracic chamber. See, when the oxygen is going to, if this is the lung, when the oxygen is going to enter into the lungs, what happens means here, whatever the volume of lungs will be there, it is going to increase. The volume of thoracic cavity, it is going to increase. If this thoracic volume is going to increase, whatever the ribs will be there, that is also going to increase. And whatever the diaphragm is there, that is also going to contract. So see here, what is the question? Raises the ribs. Due to the raise in the ribs, the external intercostal muscles. Due to what the ribs are going to raise, that is due to the external intercostal muscles. The next, B1, contraction of diaphragm. When it is going to contract? When there is an increase in the volume of thoracic cavity. Okay, A is the third one, B is the fourth one. Expiration means expiration, intrapulmonary pressure will be higher than the atmospheric pressure. That is first option. Then inspiration means intrapulmonary pressure will be lesser than the atmospheric pressure. So see here in the options, when the ribs are going to raise, when there is an external intercostal muscles are also going to be raised. So what is that? First is third one. Here in the three option, the first is third one is there, A, B and C. Then contraction of diaphragm, when it is going to contract? When there is increase in the volume of thoracic cavity. That is the fourth one. Here you see in the A and B, the second option, B option is the fourth one. Then expiration. Expiration means intrapulmonary pressure is more than the atmospheric pressure. So what it is? Third is the first one. Here the C is the first one. So in the B option you see, and D, that is inspiration, intrapulmonary pressure is lesser than the atmospheric pressure. So which is the correct option? That is the B option is the correct option. Then next, here you see 40 uh, question number 40. Here in the question number 40, you see one diagram they had given. Okay, so see here, the given figure shows diagrammatic representation of exchange of gases. Here, what is this diagram is showing means exchange of gases of alveolus. Okay, this is the alveoli. Here you can see this pod shaped structure is the alveoli, and these all are what? Body tissues. Okay, these all are what? Body tissues with blood and transport of oxygen and carbon dioxide. Here some system they had given that is going to transport the blood and oxygen and carbon dioxide. Identify the blood vessels A and D. Okay, we have to identify this A and D. See here, and also they had given C, B. First thing, this is the alveoli. Okay, here you can see some of the air is coming inside the alveoli and some of the air is going outside through the alveoli. That is, this is the inspiration process and this is the expiration process. Here what happens means when it enters into the alveoli, okay, this alveoli is surrounded by some of the vessels, and these vessels here they had given, this is the vein which is going to take the oxygenated blood from the alveoli. This is the vein. This vein, or we can also call it as the, this C option, we can also call it as the pulmonary vein. What we can call? We can call it as the pulmonary vein. So this pulmonary vein will take the oxygenated blood. Which blood? Oxygenated blood. To whom? To the heart. Okay, here the left side, the left side chambers are going to receive the what? That is the oxygenated blood. From where? From the vein which is coming from the alveoli. That's why we had named it as the pulmonary vein. The next, when it reaches to the what we call to the left side of the heart, that is left atrium and left ventricle, at that time what happens means from this left side it will go to a valve, to a artery, that is known as the, this artery is known as the, D option is a systemic artery. What it is? Systemic artery. So this systemic artery is going to take the blood from heart and it is going to reach to the body tissues, where it is going to release the oxygen to the body tissues. Here you can see the oxygen is going to released from this veins. So artery. So D is the systemic artery which will carry the oxygenated blood to whom? To the body tissues. Then from here the body tissues will utilize the oxygen and they are going to release what? They are going to release the carbon dioxide. Then this, when they are going to release the carbon dioxide into the blood, here you see, when in this way they are going to release the carbon dioxide from tissues to the blood, this blood will become the deoxygenated. What it will become? It will become the deoxygenated blood. Okay, after that you can see this particular vessel, they had given it as the A. Okay, this vessel, okay, this is going to carry the deoxygenated blood, and this particular vessel is known as the systemic vein. What it is known as? It is known as the systemic vein, which is going to carry the deoxygenated blood from the body tissues to the right side of the heart. Okay, always there is a separation of, in the mammals or in the human beings, there is a separation of chambers. There are presence of four chambers, that is two auricles and two ventricles. These four chambers are separated by some of the septa in the heart. So always the left side will receive the oxygenated blood and right side will receive. Always you keep in mind, left side is mainly meant for oxygenated blood. Only the oxygenated blood is going to received by whom? By the left side, and deoxygenated blood is going to received by the right side. So this vein is going to carry the deoxygenated blood from the body tissues to the, to where? To the right part of the heart. Then from the right side of the heart, a particular vessel is there which is going to carry the oxygenated blood to deoxygenated blood to whom? To the alveoli. From the alveoli again it is going to expire out. What it is going to expire, that is the carbon dioxide which is coming from, see, first it will releases from the tissues, then it will go to the heart, then again it will go to the alveoli. So which vessel is going to carry that deoxygenated blood from the right part or right auricle of the heart to the alveoli? Means this is known as the pulmonary artery. What it is? B is the pulmonary artery. So see here what it is. When oxygen you are going to inhale, it will go into the lungs. That is, in the lungs it will reach to the alveoli. Alveoli which is surrounded by capillaries. Capillaries which opens into the blood vessels. What is that blood vessels which are going to take the oxygenated blood from alveoli to the heart? Means that is the pulmonary vein. Wait a minute. Pulmonary vein, then from here it will carry it to the body tissues by a artery, that is the systemic artery. Then when it the tissues, body tissues are going to receive the oxygenated blood from the systemic artery, here they will utilize the oxygen and they will release the carbon dioxide. So these tissues are going to release the carbon dioxide. Who is going to carry the deoxygenated blood? Means that is the vein, systemic vein. It is going to carry it to the right side. Then again it is going to carry it right side of the heart. From the heart it is going to carry it to the lungs for the exchange process. So from the heart, who is going to carry to the alveoli? Means that is the artery. So what it is means, which option is correct? Means you see, A is the systemic vein. In this one, A is systemic vein. Here also systemic vein is there. B is the pulmonary artery. This is the pulmonary artery, and C is the pulmonary vein. Okay, C is the pulmonary vein, and D is the systemic artery. See, always when from the heart, whatever the vessels are going to carry the blood to the alveoli, always you keep in mind. See, always the arteries are going to carry the oxygenated blood. Okay, then veins are going to carry the deoxygenated blood. But when the question comes, when it is when the heart is going to pump the blood to the lungs, at that time always the here opposite is there. Okay, here you see the vein is going to carry the oxygenated blood, but except, and this vein you can call it as the pulmonary vein because it is associated or connected with what? With the lungs. And one more thing, this is the artery, and this artery we can call it as the pulmonary artery. And here always it will carry the deoxygenated blood. Okay, except these pulmonary artery and vein, other all whatever in the body the arteries and veins are there, here the arteries always carry the oxygenated blood and veins will carry the deoxygenated blood. So this is about the 40th question. Next we will go for the 41st question. Here you see, in oxygen disassociation curve, x-axis and y-axis represents. Okay, I had explained you, here this is the x-axis and this is the y-axis. X-axis represents the partial pressure of partial pressure of oxygen. Okay, what it what this x-axis represents means, it represents the partial pressure of oxygen, that is in mmHg. Okay, which one? That is the x-axis. And what about the y-axis means, here that is the percentage saturation of percentage saturation of hemoglobin. Okay, what it is, that is the y axis. So here you see x axis partial pressure of oxygen, okay, y axis percentage saturation of hemoglobin with the oxygen. So whether it is correct or wrong, next they had given percentage saturation of hemoglobin, partial pressure of oxygen. This is the wrong one. Partial pressure of carbon, this is also wrong one. Partial pressure of carbon. So first is the correct option, 41st one. Then you go for 42nd question. You see here, 42nd question. What is incorrect about oxygen binding with hemoglobin? Okay, so see here, the bond between oxygen and hemoglobin is loose bond. Four molecules of oxygen binds with four molecules of hemoglobin. Then next one, hemoglobin and oxygen binding, whatever the hemoglobin and oxygen binding is there, here you see the bond between the oxygen and hemoglobin is loose bond. Okay, this is correct option statement. Whatever the bond between the hemoglobin and the oxygen is there, that is a loose bond, not a strong bond. The next, four molecules of oxygen binds with four molecules of hemoglobin. How many molecules? See, four molecules of oxygen are there, but it is going to bond with what? Only one molecule of hemoglobin. So this is the incorrect, B is the incorrect option. Hemoglobin and oxygen binding is readily reversible combination. This is also correct. None of this we can say it is correct. So which statement is incorrect means that is the second one, B option is the incorrect option. The next 43rd question, you see, given table shows differences between vital capacity and total lung capacity. Yesterday only I had explained you about the vital capacity and total lung capacity. So let's see here. Vital capacity means it is the total amount of air which can be inhaled forcibly. Okay, it is the extra volume of air that can be breathed out. So whether this is the correct definition, see, given table shows differences between vital capacity and total lung capacity. So we will see here about the capacity and total vital capacity and total lung capacity. What is vital capacity means? It is the maximum volume of air a person can breathe in after a forced expiration, or maximum volume of air a person can breathe out after a forced inspiration. So what they had given, it is the amount of air which can be inhaled forcibly. Okay, total lung capacity means it is the volume of air, okay, accommodated in the lungs at the end of a forced inspiration. This is a wrong thing. Okay, they had given extra volume of air that can be breathed out. So that is not a force after inspiration, they are telling, but they had given after expiration. Then it is a sum total of PV plus IRV and plus ERV. Okay, this is PV is equals to this, all things vital VC is equals to total tidal volume, inspiratory reserve volume and expiratory reserve volume. This is the correct one. Here the total lung capacity means it is a sum total of vital capacity plus reserved volume. So what it is means here you see, yes, it is also correct one. It is the correct difference between them. It varies from 2500 to 3000 ml. It's not going to vary from these volumes. It is about 4600 ml. And here it varies from 3400 to 4800. This is also wrong. It is about 5800 ml. So what it is, which one is the correct difference means that is the second one. Only second is the correct option. Okay, next we will go for the next question. Here you see, Which respiratory disorder causes the irreversible distension and loss of elasticity of alveoli of lungs? So this is the this is one of the respiratory disorder where there is an distension and loss of elasticity of alveoli of lungs. Okay, where there is a loss of elasticity of alveoli of lungs, they are telling. So let's see in which disorder, in which respiratory disorder it is going to cause. Means see here, in a emphysema, it is an inflammation or abnormal distension. The D option you see here, what is going to happen means inflation or abnormal distension of bronchioles. During emphysema, there is an inflammation of bronchioles or alveolar sacs of the lungs. Many septa between alveoli are destroyed. Okay, sometimes the septums between the alveoli are going to destroyed. Then what is going to, much of the elastic tissue of lungs is replaced by connective tissue. So elasticity is going to be lost because the elastic tissues are going to replace by what? By the connective tissue. So D option is the correct option. Then tachypnea is what? Okay, see here, breathing rate above normal is called tachypnea or hyperpnea. Tachypnea is also known as the hyperpnea. What it is means, breathing rate above normal is called tachypnea or hyperpnea. So what is the correct option here means, 45th one, that is the C, rapid shallow breathing. The next, severe acute respiratory syndrome, okay, that is the SARS. Okay, this is one of the human coronavirus. What it is, it is one of the SARS is caused by human coronavirus, HCV. SARS is a acute respiratory, it is a new member of influenza virus family, which is considered as mutant from influenza virus. So here it is not a rhinovirus. Okay, it is caused by variant of common cold virus. Yes, it is caused by HCV, human coronavirus. So B option is the correct option. Then next, 47th, you see inflammation of lungs covering causing severe chest pain is here. When a severe chest pain is going to cause means pleurisy. Okay, what is pleurisy means? Pleurisy involves inflammation of tissue layers, pleura. Whatever the lungs are surrounded by pleural membrane, there is an inflammation in this pleural membrane or whatever the pleura lining the lungs and in inner chest wall, due to which there is a severe chest pain, that is known as the pleurisy. Brooder pneumonia is what it is. First of all, the pneumonia which is going to cause by what streptococcus pneumonia. Here the brooder pneumonia, which is also known as the aspergillosis. What it is known as? It is also known as the aspergillosis. Is a fungal respiratory disorder. What it is? It is going to cause by some of the fungus that is known as the fungal respiratory disorder. So here, which is that fungal fungi which is going to cause the brooder pneumonia means that is the aspergillosis. And here especially this aspergillosis is going to cause in the chicks. Okay, hence chicks, it is caused by Aspergillus fumigatus, which is that particular fungi which is going to cause the this respiratory disorder, that is Aspergillus, that is fumigatus. Okay, and here it is also, see, this particular fungal disorder is going to spread by aerosols of spores, commonly in hatcheries and all. Then lack of pulmonary surfactant producers. Surfactant means which is a wetting agent. So that deficiency of pulmonary surfactant causes the respiratory distress syndrome in newborns. Okay, so respiratory distress syndrome, especially in whom? In newborns, which may become the fatal newborns. Then 50th question, you see, black lung disease is common in. Black lung disease is a common in whom itself. This is common in whether in the coal miner, refinery worker, petrochemical industries. Black lung is a man-made occupational lung disease that are contracted by prolonged breathing of coal mine dust. Okay, coal mine dust, because the coal is black in color. That's why they had given the black lung. So continuous exposure of coal miner or dust, the disease is called black lung because it causes the lungs to look black instead of pink. Here the lungs are going to become totally black. Medically it is a type of pneumococcus called a coal worker pneumonia. So it is commonly seen in the coal miners. So this is about 50 questions which we had discussed. So tomorrow we will go through with them. Next chapter, that is the body fluids and circulation. Be thorough with that body fluids and circulation. We will discuss in the next class. Okay, thank you.